And the magazine now can best be described as a scaffold trying to reach out to the world. I think I'm adding Saba now. Hello, Saba.
Hi.
Oh, you turned your phone. I think you should. Yes.
Is this fine?
Yeah, this is fine. Can you hear me?
Yeah,
am I audible?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. And I would just like to ask our viewers if they can hear us, if we are audible. So we're just checking the sound. So that, you turned your phone again. So, as I was saying, that we are a magazine from Northeast India, and we are trying to go global with local stories. We are telling stories of the marginalized, the underreported, crisscrossing through geographical terrain and psychological barriers. So we had initiated this series of online conversations on the theme, Why Women Write? And tonight we'll talk about Gulzar Saab, Manto, translations, poetry, and more with our guest, Dr. Saba Mahmood Bashir. So I think we are ready to go. We are audible? Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So let me introduce Dr. Bashir. So Dr. Saba Mahmood Bashir is a poet, author, and translator. Her first book was a collection of poems called Memory Past. Her PhD is very interesting. It's on Gulzar Saab's poetry. And it was brought out by HarperCollins as I Swallowed the Moon, the poetry of Gulzar. She has written an analytical book on the film Andhi and has translated Gulzar, Premchand, and Manto. There's a lot of noise.
It's very clear this side.
Really? I can hear a lot of noise. Okay. Her most recent work, a recent book, is the translation of Manto, Shikari Aurte, as Women of Prey, brought out by Speaking Tiger. Saba teaches at Jamia Millia Islamia. So, Saba, I really found your PhD topic very interesting. Whenever people talk about PhD, they talk about those tedious, sleepless nights when people, you know, they go delve into a topic and they start talking about, say, this, they do research on and they step into an unknown terrain. But you decided to do your PhD on Gulzar Saab's poetry. So can you just tell us how was the experience, you know, this doing this, and finally it was also brought out as a book.
To begin with, I'd really like to thank you for having me over to have this conversation, and I can see a few of my friends and family also, so I'd like to give a little introduction of Ms. Teresa Rehman also. She is a journalist of repute. She's worked with India Today, Telegraph, Tehelka, and now she's the editor of this fascinating magazine, Thumbprint. She's a recipient of many awards on the excellence of journalism, and she's in the northeast of the country, and she's authored two very fantastic books, Mothers of Manipur and Bulletproof, which is her latest. So in fact, Bulletproof is something which we were discussing earlier also. It's a fascinating. Thank you so much for having me here. To come to your first question on my experience of working on a PhD thesis on Gulzar Saab's poetry. I did my PhD from IIT Delhi, and you know that's it's a place where you do a lot of interdisciplinary studies. So I was all my other friends who were doing their PhD, they were either in economics or sociology or linguistics, and it was very interesting. And they would come and crib and talk about qualitative analysis, quantitative analysis, data, and you know, interviews. And my data was songs and poetry. So it was, of course, it was sheer pleasure of 4 years of listening to good music, good songs, good poems, and analyzing them. But having said that, of course, it was a lot of hard work because, when you're doing a research and you're looking at something different. And for this PhD, what I did was I analyzed about 500 of his songs and the equal number of his non-film poetry, because what I tried to establish was that he is a poet for whatever he does. I mean, he can be a filmmaker also, but it's poetry that permeates through all his works. Culture. So I tried to bring out various strains of progressive writing. Would only be one good song after the other. And the house in those days, the four years of my PhD, it only rang of good songs all the time. Whereas with the other friends and colleagues, they were talking about all kinds of data, boring, mundane, they're trying to go to different places. So yeah, it was hard work, but sheer fun.
Okay. And Sabha, I don't think you need to hold your mic like this. You just leave it because you're,
clear?
Just leave it. So that is creating the noise actually. Why did you call the book, which was based on your PhD, I Swallowed the Moon, the Poetry of Gulzar? Would you explain the significance of this name?
That's a very interesting question. Thank you for that question. Initially, I had not thought of naming it as Swallowed the Moon. My first reaction was I wanted to name it. The Moon is from a translation of one of his albums, which is Chant Parosa Hai. I Swallowed the Moon is actually a translation of one of the lines from his work. It is a song from the film Omkara, Namak. And I don't know if you are very familiar with the song, it is Main Chaand Nigal Gayi. So it is and there was an interesting thing. My PhD thesis was not called I Swallowed the Moon. That was more academic in nature. It was, you know, a critical study. So, when it was coming out as a book, I definitely re-looked at my thesis and I narrowed down a little bit of portions. I trimmed certain things because from the very beginning, I wanted the book out in the popular world. I mean, I did not want it a very academic book in nature because I have pulled out portions from my thesis which have been published in academic journals. This was a book which I wanted to reach to the market because there are actually only two books on Gulzar Saab's works. On Gulzar Saab, actually, the others are the translation of his works. One is a biography which is on his films. Only it touches on the 16, 17 films that he's made. And one is a personal biography which is written by his own daughter as a personal narrative. There aren't any books on his poetry per se. So this is actually a translation from one of his own songs from the film Omkara. The song is titled Namak. And the line comes in that, Main Chaand Nigal Gayi. So it's picked up from there. And of course it's catchy, it attracts people.
Okay, mm-hmm. It definitely does. And since we started this series and we called our series Why Women Write, so although one always wonder about the difference between women writing and men writing, so do you have a take on this?
Why women write, it can be very it's different for everyone why women write, and I think the reason why people write would more or less be the same, but how women write is definitely very different from how men write. you know, women have far more challenges when they get down to write. And for all the different books that I have written, poetry, when I've always been writing poetry, that has only been a vent. I'm only trying to communicate a certain restlessness which is within, something which has disturbed me, something which has bothered me, personal or impersonal, which can be a different thing. But poetry is always a venting for me. But the other writings that I have been doing, but you know, when I say that how men write and how women write is very different, because you know, one assumes there are far more challenges, which is true also for a woman. I remember the two books that I have translated. These are the screenplays of Premchand's Godaan, Nirmala, and 10 of his short stories. These were about a decade ago or so. They came out on Doordarshan as serials. And the screenplay, this was commissioned work. It was given to me by Roli Books. They wanted it, and the screenplay was written by Gulzar Saab again. So they wanted me to translate these two things. And when I started my PhD, that was a time when my daughter was very small. She was only 3 at that time. And you know, so my writing for thesis, it was a different kind of challenge. I was running a house. I had, you know, I remember I was working for my interview and her admission into kindergarten at the same time. So, you know, it was a different process. About this Premchand and Gulzar translation that I'm saying, by that time she was about 8 or 9 and she was going for a theater workshop. And the theater workshop would be like twice a week. And it was about 5 to 6 kilometers away from my house. So it wasn't something that I could go and drop and come back. So I would drop her. It was a 2-hour twice a week. And I would sit in the, there was a cafe coffee day next to it. So these two books, Goda, Nirmala, and the other 10 short stories have been translated only at cafe coffee day. You know, and when people say, you know, I need a kind of an environment and things like that, I disagree over there. If you've got to do something, you've got to do something. And you and women are far stronger if they're determined. So the challenges are definitely way more than men. I know there would be some people who would disagree with this, but I personally feel there are more challenges, and it's just how well you manage to go about it, you deal with it, you do it. So yeah, that's it.
And so if we go back to the beginning, when did it all start? You know, when did you start writing, and when did you develop this love for Bollywood? You know, I see a lot of Bollywood here. So would you tell us something about your childhood? Yeah.
Come from a family where Bollywood magazines were a taboo. You know, okay. So we've never read Filmfare. We were given a lot of storybooks. I mean, we grew up on Enid Blyton's and Agatha Christie, and developed into classics. But film magazines and comics were a taboo in our house, in the entire family, cousins everywhere. So, I mean, that is another interesting thing, but which I'll tell you later how I got into cinema writing. But about my writing, I did write, I remember writing a poem when I was in school. I think it was in the 4th standard, which was appreciated by the teacher. So it stayed on, and I remember my mother very proudly putting it up on the door. You know, it was pasted on the door for many months for visitors to come and, you know, look at it. But when I was doing my graduation, and that was the time, and I'm from a small town, I'm from Allahabad, where, you know, we had our little old mopeds and on which we used to go to the university. And I had stopped one day at Northern India Patrika's office, and I had gone there and I had submitted a piece of, it was a little article I had submitted, and I had not mentioned anyone in the about it in the house, because I wasn't sure how good it was. This was when I was in my graduation first year. And about a week or 10 days later, it did come out, and I remember, I mean, I was fast asleep when the newspaper came, and you know, it was the father who saw it, and So then I started writing very regularly for Northern India Patrika. It was a daily in Allahabad. And by the time I was doing my master's, it was, I had a weekly feature kind of a thing. Every Friday I would be putting in an article. So that is how I actually began before I, while I was doing my graduation and post-graduation. And I was writing poems as well as articles. But about cinema is like, that's what I was telling you. I mean, I had never ever read a Filmfare and or any other. And about few years ago, there weren't any film books also, you know, especially the academic ones. Or however, as things would have it, when I was doing my PhD, they did ask me if I would like to make it, you know, what else would I like to explore. And I did come up with I wanted to look at Gulzar Saab's poetry, because there was a particular strain in his songs, that juxtaposition in his imagery, which I did not find in any other poet. So, and I was very keen on doing that. And thankfully, the supervisor was very nice. She was very helpful, Dr. Shamla Kaluri. So she also liked the idea, and that's how I went about it. It was more into getting into more into Urdu poetry. And the window was Gulzar Saab's poetry. And from there, it went into cinema. And so when I actually started doing my PhD, I read up all possible books on cinema to see how books are on cinema are being written. In fact, I came upon a couple of not so good books, and I asked a professor who teaches cinema in FTI Pune. So he said, you must read this book because this is about how not to write a book on cinema. So, you know, I even had a couple of those books, and I mean, I don't want to name those books, but so those two books were there, how not to write on cinema. But yeah, that's how I actually got into it. And once I did this book on Gulzar Saab's poetry, and then the book on Andhi came along. That was actually the day when this book came out. I Swallowed the Moon, and I was speaking with the editor, Mr. Shantanu Rai Chaudhary at HarperCollins. And then I said, why don't we? And HarperCollins has this books, little books, monographs on cinema. They had already brought out a book on Deewar and Mughal-e-Azam and Amar Akbar Anthony and Jaane Bhi Toh Yaaro. These four or five books were already there. So I toyed the idea with the editor, so if we can do it. And then he also got very excited. And then we decided, let's do a three book set kind of a thing. So initially I wanted to do the book on Namkeen. Namkeen is my favorite of Gulzar Saab's films, but what he and the other people at HarperCollins thought was that economically it was not so viable because it was never such a big hit. Then my second favorite of Gulzar Saab's films is definitely Andhi. So I did Andhi, and then they commissioned the book on Angoor to Satya Saganji, and on Ijazat to Meera Hashmi.
So how was Andhi? Because you have also written the analytical book, an analytical book on Andhi. And, you know, do you think enough academic research has been done on the popular culture in Bollywood films?
Now a lot is being done. For the last 3-4 years, a lot of that's what I'm saying, these little monographs which HarperCollins has. And again, there are some biographies also available. And again, you can divide a few biographies. Some of the biographies are very interesting work, which concentrate on more on the cinema rather than on the personal life of the actor. And again, there are two ways to look at it. If I have to write a biography, I would focus more on the work of the actor, the filmmaker, or whatever. A lot is being written, and some very good books are coming out where people are looking at poetry. You know, for instance, these monographs that I was talking about, Jaane Bhi Toh Yaaro, is written by J. R. Johnson. It's a fantastic book. Anil Zankar has written. So these are people who know cinema, they know it well, and they bring forth a different perspective to it. So for Andhi, I took about a year or a year and a half to write. And I had the rough structure in my head, the kind of chapterization. But the problem which came about that, number one, I am so much in love with this film and the songs in this film that I would, every morning I would like sit and I thought, you know, I have to write my 500 words for the day or something. I would end up watching the entire film. So I would switch off my laptop after watching for 2 hours, and then again next morning I would sit. So this went on for days and days. I really did not know how to go about it, to come and start actually writing, because I ended up only watching it. So even now, I mean, if I don't listen to the songs for a few days, you know, I get those withdrawal symptoms that you have to go back to the Andhi songs.
Okay. And what was it about Andhi that struck you?
The reason why I chose Andhi was the enigma of the songs. Of course, Andhi is also known for its controversy that it created. The controversy was that, again, a film magazine had put it on their cover that, you know, see your prime minister on screen or something like that. By then, Andhi was already running in its 24th week, and then it was banned. And then at that time, Guzarsa was at a film festival abroad, and then he had to come back, and he deleted one scene and he added another scene, which was hardly anything. It was re-released. So although the controversy was there, but my reason for drawing to the film were the songs, the chemistry between the two protagonists, JK, which is played by Sanjeev Kumar Sahab, which I think has been one of the most fascinating actors ever Indian cinema has produced. And of course, Suchitra ji. So that the kind of chemistry and that love and longingness which this film has brought out, you know, again, when people say it's a political film, I completely disagree. It's one of the most romantic films ever made. So, you know, it's not only, in this film, I could see, which I've even traced it in the book, you know, there are three romantic songs and I've tried to trace how the metaphor of traveling, it's very interestingly used by the songwriter Gulzar Sahab, and how the same metaphor is used in the three songs and how it actually changes the meaning of the relationship. Also, I mean, talking of songs, since that's my area also, the songs, it has a Qawwali, which is a political satire. And it's a kind of a fatigue of, you know, the Qawwalis you generally find either they're romantic or Sufi in nature. Here it's a political satire, which is also very interesting to analyze it, how the caricatures or the backdrop that the filmmaker has used, it's rather fascinating.
Mm-hmm. And why did you get into translation? You know, why do you think is translation important in a country like India? You know, it's a linguistically diverse country like India.
I think it's all the more reason in a country like India. So, okay, first, why did I get into translation? I started translating when I was doing my PhD. The number of songs and the poems which I wanted to use, obviously, since my PhD thesis is in English, I had to use it in English. A few of the things were already there. A few of the translations were already there, which were available and they were published. However, I didn't want to use it for two reasons. Number one, I looked at that poetry in a different light. Number two, only a few of them were available. So it wasn't nice if I pick up a translation by someone else and the other poem I translate on my own. So what I did, I translated whatever references I have used, whatever poems I have used or songs I have used, I translated it. And it is then I realized that as I was really enjoying the process of translation. And as luck would have it, after my PhD, I started teaching at Jamia Millia Islamia. And I always got a paper to teach on translation. We have a diploma in translation at Jamia. And, you know, that is the point when I really got more involved in the process of translation and looking at it from various aspects. And now, I mean, translation has reached a point that for me, this is a kind of a meditation. I can actually, you know, sink into it. I can be lost. I thoroughly get one. And there are times when I think I start thinking in two languages, or, you know, there is a certain word. And even when you're striking a conversation with someone and there's an unusual word and you try and think of, you know, a kind of a word, what would be in the other language. So, yes, I have been translating ever since I've done my PhD, and especially again when we think that translation, it's, I don't know why we always think that we're translating everything into English, which is not the case, and especially in a country like India, multilingual, multicultural, we should be able to translate all our regional languages, our vernacular from one language into the other. All literature in Kashmiri should be available in Manipuri, or, you know, Assamese literature should be available in Malayalam. So we still have a lot of work that within the country we have to make sure that our literature reaches the different parts of the nation.
Mm-hmm. And how was the experience or the difference in translating Gulzar, Premchand and Manto?
Oh yes, it was different. I think every writer has his or own characteristic in their when they write. For Gulzar Saab, it was he uses a lot of his language is very, you know, he has a lot of image in his language. There is a lot of sound, so you know, chapak. I mean, then these are just sounds, and you have to, and especially if it's a song, the famous Marches song, chapa chapa charkha chale. So again, when you are translating it and you want to maintain that rhythm, so it all gets difficult. So for Gulzar Saab, the challenge was definitely the image that he created with his poetry, and the song that he brought, and the sound that he brought forth. With Premchand, it was, I mean, I've translated about 10, 11 of his short stories, and not only from the screenplay which Gulzar Saab wrote, also for the Penguin has brought out a 4-volume. So I've translated a couple of there also. It is how deep-rooted it is in the cultural nuances. You know, I always give this example in the class also when I was translating Godan, and there's a desire to possess a cow, and you know how Hori brings the cow in the house, and he said, and the sentence in Hindi is, Hori gai le aaya aur aangan mein baanthi, and then the wife is so excited when she starts, you know, caressing the cow. She doesn't use the word gai, it's gaiya. So now when in Hindi, or you from the Hindi belt, you know the difference between gai and gaiya, that is, it's more, you know, more lovingly. But when you're trying to translate it, that is the challenge. So for Premchand, it is always how to bring out that nuances. For Manto, it was a different ballgame altogether. He uses language in a rather double-edged sword. For example, the book that I've translated, it's in Urdu, it's titled Shikari Orte. And these are short stories which are not partition stories, because largely we know Manto with his partition short stories. This is his humorous pieces about bold women, flirtatious women. They're out in the world enjoying themselves. And so he has this use, and he uses the pun all the time. For example, there's this short story which is titled Hajamat. Now, Hajamat is a haircut or a shave in Urdu. But in a very colloquial term, and if you are familiar with, you know, if there are people you're familiar with the Urdu speaking, ki bhai, it's not something that you're being pulled up, but arre unhone hamari hajamat bana di, and someone who pulled me up. And this is a joke between a husband and wife, you know, ki wo biwi hamari hajamat bana rahi hai. And on the superficial level, she was asking him to go for a haircut, you know, jaake baal katwa ke aao, daadi banwao. So, and the pun on the play of the word hajamat. So, you know, you have this challenge, and that's just one odd example. Manto's work is full of these double-edged sworded words.
Okay. So, would you like to read out something? Something interesting for our readers? Yeah.
Should I read out a song with a translation from Gulzar Saab's work?
Sure.
Or should I read out my poem? Whatever you tell me.
The song, okay. And then we can listen to your poem as well. And something from Shikari Orte?
Orte?
Yeah, that sounds so interesting.
I'm reading out this English translation, or do you want me to read the Urdu also of a Gulzar Saab poem?
Yeah. Please do both. Just that, you know, I'm not from the Urdu belt, so my knowledge of Urdu is limited.
Fair enough, but this is rather Hindustani. This is another poem where you know, we had a lot of issues in terms of translation. It's about uple. The poem is translated uple. Uple are the cow dung cakes, you know, and in villages where the cow dung cakes are patted and dried, and they used as fuel. So, okay, I'll read the poem and then I'll tell you the issue that we had. The poem is titled Uple. छोटे थे माँ उपले थापा करती थी, हम उपलों पर शक्लें गूंधा करते थे, आंख लगाकर, कान बनाकर, नाक सजाकर, पगड़ी वाला टोपी वाला, मेरा उपला तेरा उपला, अपने अपने जाने पहचाने नामों से उपले थापा करते, हंसता खेलता सूरज रोज सवेरे आकर गोबर के उपलों पे खेला करता था, रात को आंगन में जब चूल्हा जलता है हम सारे चूल्हा घेर के बैठे रहते थे, किस उपले की बारी आई, किसका उपला राख हुआ, एक मुन्ना था, एक दशरथ था, बरसों बाद मैं शमशान में बैठा सोच रहा हूं, आज की रात इस वक्त के जलते चूल्हे में एक दोस्त का उपला और गया। I'll read the translation now. She would scratch faces on those, carve eyes, make ears, decorate a nose. With a turban, with a cap, my cake, your cake, with familiar names, would pat dry dung cakes. A bright, playful sun would come every morning to play upon those. When the cooking fire would burn in the courtyard at night, all of us would sit around it. Whose cake would be lit? Whose would be burnt to ashes? It was Pandit's. One was Munna's, one Dashrath's. Years later, I sit at a crematorium and think, tonight, in this burning fire of time, the dung cake of another friend has gone. So the challenge with this particular poem, because it was intense, it starts with there are little children who are playing about making of dung cakes and the you know, the mother would put it and use it as a fuel. And it ends with where the poet is sitting in a crematorium. And because they used to give names to those dung cakes on the children who had made them. So he's thinking about a friend who's there on the fire. So again, you know, about these challenges and how he would. So this is the poem. And about shikari orte.
I think there's a message from Saira Mushtaba. Wonderful session, loved it as a cinema buff and translator. I'm sorry, I can't read it. I'm not able to read it. It's like, okay. Thank you, Saira.
Is there a, I don't know if there's a question. No, there's not a question.
No, there's not a question, just a comment. Huh.
She's appreciating us. Thank you, Saira.
Oh, she said the session can be called Ye Kalamkar Aurte.
Wow.
Well, as I said, my knowledge of Urdu is limited, so I rather not tread into that and not start speaking in Urdu because people will start running away. Anyway.
From this collection, I can read a little portion from, there was this short story, which is, Auradzat. I'll just read out, it's Auradzat. So here I just have a little portion in English. Ashok met Maharaj Ji at the race course, and they became great friends at that. For Maharaj Ji, owning racehorse horses was not just a hobby but an obsession. His massive stables had horses of the finest breeds, just at his palace, the domes of which could be clearly seen from the race, housed artifacts of all kinds. When Ashok visited the palace for the first time, Maharaji spent hours showing him the various antiques which he had collected from all corners of the world. Ashok was highly impressed by the young Maharaji's taste. So this is just a beginning. I'll give a brief so that it's you get a an idea into this short story. It's a short story where Ashok is a character who visits Maharaj, and the Maharaj shows him a film, and which is apparently one of the first blue films that comes into India. It's a porn. So he's very shocked at the idea of how a porn film is made. The very fact that, and he's very confused at how is it shot, what are people thinking. And the initial effect on Ashok is that he's shocked, but later on we see that he's interested and he wants to borrow it. And Manto being Manto, so Ashok borrows it and he shows it to his friends and he shows it to his wife. So, and there are different reactions of how men react to it and how women react to it, and it's interesting. So this is book, it's titled Women of Prey. It's brought out by Speaking Tiger. It came out in October 2019. So these are interesting short stories. These are 9 short stories about very smart, bold, interesting women who are out to rule. They enjoy themselves, and there's nowhere that you see that Manto is being very critical of them. He's not judgmental. He is just appreciating the fact, you know, that these are bold, flirtatious women who are just enjoying themselves.
Why do you think he is writing about them? You know, I mean, in that age, is he trying to provoke the readers?
No, I don't think so. See, about Manto is, it's like he always tried to write what he saw. He said, I do not believe in sugarcoating things. And although we know him more as a story writer of the partition, and but unfortunately he has a huge oeuvre of work which goes beyond his partition stories. We keep on reading those 7-8 short stories, Toba Dekh Singh, Bhu, Khodo, Thanda Ghosht. I mean, we kind of neglect what his other. He is a great writer of humor, and he wrote a lot of humorous stories. There are so many stories which are on the interaction between husband and wife, and you know what we call nokjhok. These are little pieces where there's just a communication. There's one in this collection also, Rehmat-e-Khudabandi ke Phool, where there's just a conversation between a husband and wife. So he believed in depicting whatever he saw. So, yeah, I think.
And, you know, he was ahead of his time, would you say? His thought and his ideas.
He had the courage of writing what he wanted to write. I mean, and there is again a way that we can say that maybe he was ahead, but, you know, he had the valor, the charisma, the power of just writing what he wanted to mm-hmm. write. So, well, mm-hmm. I mean, I put it in the introduction also, these two short story writers in Urdu, Manto as well as Ismak Chughtai, we've just kind of categorized them with 2 or 3 of their works, and we've not gone beyond them. Humor in Manto is fascinating, so we need to, you know, look at the other works also. And his portrayal of women, I mean, there are 2 sketches which are there in this book. One is on Sitara Devi and the other is on Paro Devi. These were dancers and actors in the cinema in the 1940s. So the kind of picture that he draws of Bombay of the 40s is fascinating. And he wrote a couple of story and screenplay also for a couple of films. So he was there in Bombay in the 40s, and it's fascinating the kind of the picture that he draws of the city.
Mm-hmm. There's a comment from Prerna Jain, and she said, can you please read a portion of Shikari Aurte?
Shikari Aurte in Urdu.
Yeah.
Right now, I don't have it. I mean, I wish I had pulled out a portion.
Okay.
I'll do that for Prerna Ji. I'll take out a portion. Or maybe in the links, in the comments later on tomorrow, I'll read out and post it in the link as an answer to Prerna Ji's. Yeah,
maybe you can read out a English portion. You have the book with you.
Okay, this is a portion from Meerut Ki Khenchi. Meerut Ki Khenchi is again, when I was talking about the challenges in translation, Tenchi is the scissors, and the connection is here about Meerut Tenchi. There is this woman, Paro, who was from Meerut, but she used to speak a lot, and she was very, you know, witty. So I've titled the short story as Meerut's Sharp Wit. And this is not a short story per se. This is a sketch on Paro Devi. And I'm reading out a portion which involves the actor Ashok Kumar. So since we all are very familiar with Ashok Kumar Saab, so, and this is a conversation which happened between Ashok Kumar Saab and Manto. Many days passed. The shooting was happening regularly. One evening, when Ashok and I was going back home, he slowed the car down near Shivaji Park, where Paro stayed, and said, "Manto, can I tell you something interesting?" There was a strange quaver in his voice. For a second, I wondered what it could be. "Tell me." Ashok started laughing. "Do you remember the day we had gone to Paro's house for dinner, and she had got up to help me to wash my hands?" I remembered how Ashok had returned worried. "Yes, yes." In the bathroom, as she handed me the towel, she whispered, "Come alone tomorrow, 6:30 in the evening." I got scared, threw the towel and came out. Ashok had now stopped the car by the side of the road. "Did you go?" I asked. "Yes." Ashok took his hand off the steering wheel and started rubbing them furiously. "But even from there, I ran off. What exactly happened? Tell me the whole scene." I wanted all the details. "I'm a coward. I don't know what happens to me in these moments." She made me sit on the sofa and sat down on the carpet next to me. She made me two pegs and drank some herself. And then she started professing her love for me. I kept listening and trembling. When she pressed my hand, I got startled and shook it off with great force. Her eyes had welled up with tears, but then they suddenly disappeared. She started smiling. "Aya Ashok, I was only testing you." I was flabbergasted when I heard this. As I got up, she continued, "Ashok Saab, I think of you as my brother." I didn't say a word and came downstairs. I sat in the car, got home, and after half a peg thought, "What a shame. What was the harm if I..." There was great remorse in Ashok's voice. "Yes, there was no harm," I said. And Ashok seemed even more crestfallen. And I liked her too. Hearing this, I recalled the scene which was being filmed every night at 9 o'clock in the extreme cold outside the studio. People dancing and singing in extreme joyous celebration. Ashok lost in the arms of his heroine Veera, and Paro standing on one side alone in her melancholy. So this is how this little sketch ends, and Manto brings in the episode where Ashok Kumar Saab says that how Paro had asked him to come over, and Ashok Saab, being a thorough gentleman, got very flabbergasted and scared, and he rushes out and he goes home. And in all probability, to save her face, Paro Devi says that she was only, you know, testing him, and she also considered him as her elder brother. But how Manto ends it with saying that Ashok Kumar seemed very unhappy at this, that, you know, he did not have enough courage. So this is the humor that he brings forth, and he talks about it. And while translating this, you know, it was so exciting, both this one as well as on the sketch on Sitara Devi. You know, there were film studios being mentioned. There were being the filmmakers of that time, of the early 40s, mid 40s. And I started reading up more. And since I have been reading and trying to write in cinema for the last 10 years, it went into a different research altogether. You know, you kind of understand how cinema worked at that time, how films were being made. It was more of a collaborative effort at that time. Rather, it is now. You know, everyone would get together. Everyone would sit together and write the story. So this was an interesting piece which I wanted to read out.
Mm-hmm. Saira has a query. Which female character by Manto has struck you the most?
I think this one, Paro Devi, the one which I read out, Meerut Tenchi, he has titled in Urdu. and even Sitara for that matter. Sitara and Parodevi, yeah. These are the two characters which, because these two are also modeled on people who were already there. So you kind of, you know, get more involved reading about them and understanding them, the nuances that they bring forth. The other characters, I mean, it's kind of fiction. And the title story, Shikari Aurtein, these are actually three little anecdotes. These are anecdotal where there are three women who are on a tonga at night. So even that's interesting. But my favorite would definitely be Paro. Mm-hmm.
And coming back to translation, did you ever find translation challenging?
All the time. All the time. Translation is, you know, in terms of the process of translation, what I personally try to do is, like, I try and do it as much as possible at one go and then go back to it and then see which is the right word. You know, it's just like even when we teach translation, it's like we have to kind of do a lot of unlearning, you know, in translation. Especially, I mean, I don't believe in kind of synonyms. You know, every word has a specific meaning and it would fit in over there. So, it's where, which is the right word, which is fitting in. And then you go on looking at the syntax. Every language has its own syntax, its own cultural nuances. So, how are you, and once you finish translating, and can you close your eyes and visualize the same thing that you visualized when you read it in the source language? So is the target language bringing out the same image what the author had brought out? So if you manage to reach close to the author, it's a good enough translation. I mean, a translator can never do be very just to the author. But I mean, you can do it to the best of your ability to go closest to the author, to retain all the nuances from the source language into the target language.
Mm-hmm. And when you teach translation to your students, what are the do's and don'ts that you tell them?
I mean, do's is translate. Translation is like you only learn translation by translating. You keep on translating, you keep on practicing, you keep on polishing. The nuances will only come forth when you go on polishing it and chiseling it. Don't is when you're translating a particular piece, you have to be very familiar with the author also. Not only about that language, you need to know the kind of work that author has done. You have to get into the skin of the author properly to be able to translate it well. And again, for literary translations, I mean, journalistic translations or non-literary translation is something which is different. For literary translation, one has to be, you know, look at it very differently.
And you also have to understand the social milieu.
Absolutely. Yeah. The not only the social, but even the political milieu. Social, political, economic. For example, with Premchand, there were so many stories where you see the exodus of the farmers were unhappy there, and we see them coming into the cities, and you talk about the kind of industrial revolution that was happening in the early 1920s. So the situation that the country was in, social, political, economic situation, everything, you have to be very familiar with the social milieu, and you have to be very familiar with the resource language, the nuances. Knowing a language is not enough. You should have read a lot in that language to be able to know how that language is used. What is the, how are the idiomatic references being used? Only, and you have to be very, of course, be very comfortable with the target language.
And what about your personal biases? There are certain things you don't agree, and then if it comes out in your, you know, the translation, how do you handle
thankfully, I haven't had that, because again, you know, I'm doing these literary works. I'm doing poetry and I'm doing short stories and novels. So I have, and these are the three authors that I have translated, Gulzar Sahab, Premchand and Manto. So thankfully, and I don't think I would pick up an author if I disagree on ideological terms or the political standing. I don't think I'll be comfortable enough to pick up an author to translate. And again, it's a translator's prerogative to to choose. Because, you know, if your heart is not in it, if your ideology is not matching, I don't think you can do justice. So might as well not do it. And especially one of the main aim of translation is to reach out to people who cannot read that language, who do not understand that language. So all the more reason if it's ideologically different from yours, might as well step back and not translate.
Mm-hmm. No, there could be occasions when you say you particularly like that book, but there are certain terms and, you know, certain words which were acceptable then, but now it sounds, now it's derogatory, you know, when you think about it. Yeah. So, you know, if you think about that social context, that social milieu, it was perfectly fine, you know. And the author used
it
then.
You have to retain that. Yes, you have to retain that. For example, with Manto, we do not use the word prostitutes anymore. We use the word sex workers. But if he has used it, and especially in the manner in which he is using it, I have to be true to the author. I might disagree with him on many things, but again, at the end of the day, this piece belongs to the author. It does not belong to me. I do not own that piece. So I will be true to the author. Yes, you're right about terminology. Such words definitely come across. But again, if it was written in the 1940s and these are the words which were being used at that time, I will. And even for that matter, even abuses, explicits. I mean, you wouldn't use it if you're writing. But if you're translating and these words come across, you translate it and you use it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because it's, as I said, it's an author's piece. The author owns that piece. I only have to be true and just to the author.
Mm-hmm. And it's been a very interesting conversation, actually. And I was dreading it, actually, because I don't know much of Urdu. you explained everything so well. And I was just wondering if you are planning to delve deeper into Bollywood, you know, your passion.
Yeah, absolutely.
In future.
I am itching to write more. Let's see. I definitely have a book proposal at hand. Let's see how things go out. I am all for writing on cinema, but somehow with my PhD thesis also, I kind of disagree with the word Bollywood. You know, it's a rehash from Hollywood, and our cinema is completely different. So I try and call it Hindustani cinema because, you know, that's the language. And Hindustani is a language which is a mix of Hindi, Urdu, Punjabi, and a little bit of English. So there are so many, it's an amalgamation of so many languages, so many cultures. So yes, I want to write more on Hindustani cinema. I want to translate more. So translation is a kind of, you know, it's a balm for me. So I've just finished another piece. It's just a small piece by Premchand again, and translation is on.
So going back to your childhood, when you know you said film magazines were also not allowed in your house. So how do your family? How do they react now when they see that you are?
I think they're still confused. I think my brother is also watching it. I saw him live a while ago. And I myself was not fond of films. You know, I thought films, I mean, you end up wasting a lot of time. And when I was in college, and other friends would go for to watch a film. And I would say, you know, I would waste about 4 hours or 5 hours to watch a film. And watching films, I only give credit to my husband, who's a cinema buff, to the extent that when I got married, I mean, I ended up watching films like First Day, First Show. And I realized that I was enjoying it. And then there was a film that he wanted to watch and we didn't get the tickets. And we got the tickets of the first row. And I ended up watching that also with the neck. So watching films, I only started after I got married. So that bug is thanks to the husband.
So, okay.
Yeah, before that, I mean, maybe I wasn't exposed to so much of cinema. But and now I end up watching anything and everything.
Okay.
And not only because I want to keep myself abreast, but because I enjoy it. I. Mm-hmm.
Do you also watch regional cinema or
Not
just
much.
Hindi cinema? Okay.
Not much. I am focusing only on
Hindi
cinema.
Hindi. So it was lovely talking to you, and in fact we could go on and on, but then I think we are running out of time. So I don't think there are any more queries, but you can always get in touch with Sabha, and if you want to clear your doubts about Gulzar Sahab, and we wish you all the best for your other ventures, forthcoming ventures, and enjoying the conversation, says Dr. Fardina Hussain.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a delight. It was a delight to be here. Lovely speaking with you. And thank you for all those who watched.
It was very refreshing also. Thank you so much. I needed this break. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Good night. So, thank you so much.